Books on Tape presents The Late Bloomer's Revolution by Amy Cohen, read for you by the author. Chapter 1, The Fixer Upper. I grew up thinking my mother had the answer to everything. Watch any black and white film, and she always knew some obscure fact about an actor with one line. "See the fishmonger behind the ox? The one who's yelling, 'Slay the hunchback?'" she'd say. "His name was Skids Monroe. He came out of the Yiddish theater and was tragically maimed in a Ferris wheel accident." She knew about words. "The term steatopagus means characterized by fat, about the hips and buttocks," she explained. She grabbed a pillowy section of her thigh just below her tennis skirt, adding, "All of this right here is steatopagia, and once it was considered not cellulite, but a highly desirable benchmark of fertility." She pointed at me. "Remember that next time you say you look hideous in a bathing suit." And she knew about men. For my mother, there were only two answers to any question involving love: he'd be back, or I was better off without him. At 16, when my first boyfriend, Cliff Green, said we should see other people, I was crushed, despairing in a way I'd never experienced. "My life is over," I wept. "Sweetheart, I know you're upset, but give me the knife," my mother said, when I took to eating whole pound cakes in one sitting. She began her pep talk, as she often did, by free associating. "We all liked Cliff, and it's probably time I told you that although you and your father thought it was your little secret, I knew Cliff snuck out of the house every morning. I could hear him tromping through the living room, then slamming the kitchen door." I was sitting on a low stepladder, my elbows resting on my knees, scraping the cream filling out of a pile of soggy Oreos I planned to put back in the cookie jar. My mother was standing behind me, wearing a flowered navy and yellow kimono we had picked out together on our trip to Japan. Her hair stopped just below her chin. It was entirely gray by this point, a crisp platinum, but her face remained almost without a wrinkle. Her wide, soft cheeks, modest nose, and lively hazel eyes looked much the way they had a decade before. "I'm glad that you confided in me about being depressed about your relationship. At first, I was afraid you and Cliff were smoking pot, and that's why you had the munchies," she said, using a new bit of slang she'd learned at the Just Say No to Drugs sisterhood luncheon at the synagogue. She tossed out an empty quart of butter pecan ice cream I'd eaten and another of mint chip, from which I'd systematically picked out all the chips. "But now that I know you're depressed, the long afternoon naps make sense." She stood behind me, tenderly picking cookie crumbs out of my hair. "Pussycat, trust me, I'm positive. He'll be back."
"You really think so?"
"Mark my words," she said. "I promise." 2 months later, Cliff came back. When I fell in love with a boy named Ian, freshman year of college, who told me he loved me in a way he had never loved anyone before, enough to admit to me, and only me, that he was gay, his mascara smearing as he wept, my mother consoled me with, "Better now than in 30 years. She put her arm around me. "Could you really get serious with a man who wore a bustier?" adding finally, "You're better off without him." At 24, Jay McPhee ended our relationship of 2 years, explaining that while his preferred model of love was the dog bone, namely two separate independent entities bound by a long, sturdy bridge, he said long twice, as in long, long, sturdy bridge, my ideal was what he called the pretzel, where two people are twisted together, fused in several places, preventing any opportunity for individuality or escape. "I'm not a pretzel," I said desperately. "Oh, but you are," he said. "I can be a dog bone," I pleaded. "I can. Give me a chance." I didn't think Jay and I were right for each other, but I had always hoped it would be my choice, not his, whether to suffer a life of regret and stifling mediocrity. "He said you were an independent. That's ridiculous," my mother said, reaching for the overnight bag I'd brought to stay at my parents' apartment until I felt better. She led me into my old bedroom, still decorated with the many cat posters I collected before we found out I was allergic. "Not independent," she scoffed. "Mark my words, he'll be back." And when that never happened, she assured me, "You're better off without him." Right around the time I turned 26, when I reluctantly broke up with David Orlean because he complained I was too independent and career-minded, my mother added a new saying to her repertoire. "People who want to be married are married," she said. thrilled to have coined a phrase that could be so deep and yet so simple. "Huh?" I said. "I don't get it." "People who want to be married are married," she repeated. "Look at that woman, the one I showed you in the paper, who's blind now because her husband threw acid in her eyes. Even though she knew he had mistresses, even though he maimed her, she stayed married to him." She nodded and folded her arms as if to say, "Am I a genius or what?" I was confused. "Okay, and?" "So if you really wanted to be married, you would be." She clapped her hands in a single loud strike. "That's the answer. When you really want it, it will happen." A year later, it still hadn't happened, and I was really starting to want it. There had been another David. This time it was David Soloway, a man I'd met in Los Angeles, where I'd just graduated from film school. He was dedicated to me and talked often about marriage, but we had problems. He always wanted me to wear short shorts, the kind I thought should only be worn by women who referred to their boss as my pimp. And he mentioned often that he didn't judge women who got breast jobs or liposuction at any age. He could also be very critical. He once told me about an ex-girlfriend who purred in his ear, "I want you inside me." "I want you inside me," he said with disgust. "What kind of thing was that to say? Say I need that huge hard cock in my hot box, or your cock is so fucking huge, just looking at it makes me want to come. Or fuck me with that unbelievably huge cock, but I want you inside me? Was that supposed to turn me on?" I was sad after we broke up. I knew it was the right thing, but I still found myself wondering how many chances you get in life to find the right person. Did you get 3, 5, less? Had I already blown it and just didn't know it yet? Should I have held on to him because I might not find anything better? I had also recently weathered the unanimous rejection of the first screenplay I'd ever written. It was called Please to Meet Me, about a chronically depressed 30-year-old single woman who hates her life and goes back in time to prevent her teenage self from growing up to be a 30-year-old single woman who hates her life. My hope was that it would be a feel-good comedy for the Zoloft set, proof that overwhelming psychological issues, immune to both therapy and medication, could be easily reversed with the aid of a time machine. While I got a few studio meetings out of it, in the end, there was no sale. I was a big, pacing, jittery loser in work and love, and once again, there was my mother, eager to put me back together. "What you need is a trip to Prague in May with me," she announced. In the past, the two of us had traveled together to places like China, Japan, and Holland. We went to Beijing and Shanghai in the late 70s, where we sampled jellyfish, sliced web duck's feet, and something we were later told was braised snake. When we were in Amsterdam, we rented a car to explore the countryside, and my mother accidentally drove the wrong way down a single bicycle path, where angry riders threw apples at our windshield. "I thought the Dutch were supposed to be so peaceful," my mother said as we scraped applesauce off the front hood. And now she wanted us to visit Prague, a city she felt promised both exciting architecture and the possibility of more adventures. She told my father he'd have to fend for himself for 10 days, and off we went. The flight was easy, and everything was proceeding smoothly until we went through immigration. Everyone else moved promptly through the line, and then they got to us. The official looked confused as he examined my mother's form. "What's this mean?" he said, his heavily lidded eyes narrowing. I looked at her form. "Mom, did you have to write that?" She smiled when she realized what he was pointing at. "I'm a career volunteer," she explained. "That's my profession. I raise money for charities that support communities becoming self-sufficient. We build hospitals and schools, but I don't receive a salary." He shrugged and stamped her passport. In the cab to the hotel, my mother repeated her delight at the wonderful rate we'd gotten. "The hotel is right in the heart of the city," she said. "I done good." That's what we thought until we got to the hotel and found out it was under renovation. My first thought upon seeing our room was that it had been designed by an architect who specialized in third world prisons. The bed seemed like something a monk would sleep on after he'd forsaken his worldly possessions. As if that wasn't bad enough, our window was boarded up with a splintery piece of wood to keep out the dust from the construction site outside. When the bellboy tried to tell us what time breakfast was served, he had to yell over the sound of wrecking balls and heavy machinery. We tried to switch hotels, but it was May, and the only thing available was 40 minutes outside the city. "Okay," my mother said, so we won't spend any time in the hotel. Who wants to anyway?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.